Students, today I'll be continuing the chapter Biotechnology Principles and Processes. We have already discussed in the previous class what is biotechnology, what are the principles of biotechnology, what is the need for genetic engineering, as well as what is traditional advantages of genetic engineering over traditional hybridization. So all these we have studied in the previous class. Hope you all have understood that. So today I'll be proceeding with the next part of this chapter, that is processes and terms related to biotechnology. So today I'll be taking up processes and terms related to genetic engineering. So as I have already told, the major principles of biotechnology or the two techniques on what basis this biotechnology is going to be producing different products as well as different techniques are genetic engineering and other one is maintenance of sterile ambience. Now for the human use, multiple products that is being produced in large amounts, in the large scale production is because of the technique genetic engineering. So we are going to deal with the genetic engineering topic. We are going to see what is exactly is genetic engineering. Genetic engineering is also known as recombinant DNA technology. So in this genetic engineering, there are certain terms and processes related. Now, as I told the definition of genetic engineering, so what is genetic engineering? It is going to deal with the manipulation of the genes in an organism. You are going to alter the genetic composition of an organism by the techniques of biotechnology known as genetic engineering, wherein either you are going to remove a gene or you are going to insert another gene in order to change the genetic composition to produce a fruitful products in the large amounts. That is done by genetic engineering. So while performing this recombinant DNA technology or genetic engineering, you are going to come across certain terms and processes. So today I will be dealing with those terms and processes one by one. Because in the further topic, when you're going to see the other processes and all, you'll be going to see the different types of terms, techniques and all. So first you should be aware of what are these terms and technologies, you'll get to use to this, right? So one by one we are going to see. Number one, that is gene cloning. So in genetic engineering, there is a process known as gene cloning. What is this gene cloning? So gene cloning can be defined as ability of an alien DNA sequence to replicate and multiply into number of identical copies when linked to origin of replication in a vector. I repeat, it is the ability of the DNA sequence to replicate and multiply. So what we mean by clone means you are going to produce the identical copies of DNA. So what is all about this genetic engineering is what? You are going to deal with the molecular basis, that is the genes. And genes are nothing but they are the DNA sequences. So this gene cloning is a process. Now in a genetic engineering, the main advantage is what? You are going to isolate a particular gene from some organism and you are going to insert it into the required organism where this gene can express and produce a product. Yes or no? So in order to get that product, the first thing is the gene has to be replicated because it is a foreign gene. It is a foreign gene and this foreign gene first must be replicated, then only you are going to produce a product. So we are going to replicate this particular gene in the organism by a process known as gene cloning, wherein you are going to produce the identical copies of DNA. So gene of interest, okay, it is the ability of the DNA sequence to produce the identical copies of DNA by self-replication processes when this gene of interest is linked to the another DNA, that is known as vector DNA. That particular process is known as gene cloning. Because when you see, you are going to express this gene in another organism. wherein that particular organism cannot produce the product. For example, you are going to produce insulin, okay, in the E. coli cells, that is bacteria. Whereas in origin or in natural, in general, this insulin is produced in the human beings, right? So that the same thing you are going to produce in the E. coli cell. So before you could do that, this particular gene has to be copied to number of copies of DNA. Then you are going to introduce that into the E. coli cell, and then you are going to produce the required DNA, multiple copies of DNA. That particular process is known as gene cloning. Second, it is gene transfer. Now we have already produced the identical copies of the DNA, that is the gene of interest. Now you should transfer the gene of interest into the required organism, that is known as host cell. Right? In order to produce it into the host cell, this gene has to be transferred through some types of techniques known as gene transfer techniques. Means transferring the recombinant DNA which is already cloned here and it is attached to the another DNA known as vector DNA. Together it is forming the recombinant DNA that you are going to insert into the host cell to produce the gene of to produce the required gene product or the product or a character. That is known as gene transfer. So it can be defined as introduction of recombinant DNA into the recipient cell using some techniques called gene transfer. Next, origin of replication. What is this origin of replication? Now, for example, in the human body, the DNA has to get replicated. So if you have already studied the cell cycle and cell division, during the cell division process, the first thing what is happening in the interphase, in that S phase. So in the S phase of interphase, the DNA replication is going to take place. When the DNA replication has to take place, the DNA synthesis and the DNA amount of DNA is going to be doubled. When this replication is going to take place, when there is an enzyme known as DNA polymerase enzyme, it is going to detect the DNA sequence. It's going to detect the DNA sequence that is going to initiate the replication. Okay? And that particular DNA sequence is known as origin of replication. When you want to produce or when you want your gene of interest to get copied into the other organism or the host organism, then you are going to link the DNA or the gene of interest to the vector DNA, okay, that has the origin of replication. Then it has the capacity to independently replicate in the host organism. So the origin of replication is nothing but the chromosomal DNA consists of a specific DNA sequence that helps or the responsible for the initiation of DNA replication. Next we are going to see vector. What is vector? Vector is nothing but it is defined as a DNA molecule that is capable of carrying the gene of interest into the host organism. Now how the vector is, see, if you introduce directly the gene of interest into the host organism, the gene of interest cannot be replicated into the host organism unless and until the gene of interest is linked to the vector DNA. So the gene of interest along with the vector DNA, okay, when it is introduced into the host organism, it has the capable of carrying the foreign DNA to the host cell and it has the capacity of self-replicating in the host organism. So this vector DNA will have the origin of replication. So whatever the gene of interest you are linking to the vector DNA, okay, this origin of replication uses the DNA polymerase of the host organism and it is going to multiply the gene of interest along with the genomic DNA. So when the genomic DNA is multiplying or replicating along with the same time, even the gene of interest is also getting replicated. So the vector is nothing but it is going to carry the gene of interest to the host organism and is helping in the replication process. Then fifth point, that is recombinant DNA. Now what is this recombinant DNA? This genetic engineering, we are also telling this genetic engineering as a recombinant DNA technology. So what is this recombinant DNA? Now you're not introducing directly the gene of interest into the host organism, nor you're introducing the only vector DNA into the host organism. Since for the gene of interest to be multiplied in the host organism and to be carried into the host organism, we need a vector DNA, right? So linking of this gene of interest and the vector DNA together, it is known as recombinant DNA. So linking of alien piece of DNA or the foreign DNA or the gene of interest to the vector DNA, that makes up a new combination of the circular replicating DNA, which is created in the laboratory, that is in vitro, and that is known as recombinant DNA. Right? See, we are combining two different DNAs. One is vector DNA and one more is a gene of interest or the foreign DNA, which is not of the host organism. So together it is forming a new combination, which is known as recombinant DNA. Next, it is plasmid. What is the plasmid? Plasmids are a type of vectors. Plasmids are the type of vectors which are extra chromosomal DNA. As you already studied the plasmids in the cell, the unit of life chapter, right? They are found in the bacteria. And these are self-replicating or autonomously replicating small circular double-stranded DNA, which is segregated from the genomic DNA. The chromosomal DNA and the plasmid DNA are segregated, and these are going to produce some antibiotic resistance properties. Right? So the plasmids are extensively used in recombinant DNA technology as vectors to carry the gene of interest into the host organism. And these plasmids, they possess the properties of vectors. So plasmids are used as vectors. Restriction enzymes. Now what are these restriction enzymes? So genetic engineering is all about introducing the gene or combining two different genes or removal of gene. Yes or no? So in order to form a new combination of the DNA or to produce a recombinant DNA, what we require is, so usually the gene of interest, or you are going to attach the gene of interest to the vector DNA to form the recombinant DNA. Now from where this gene of interest we are going to get? So a particular organism has a genetic material or the genomic DNA. From that you are going to cut apart, it has different types of chromosomes that are coding for different proteins or the characters. Now, whatever the desired character you want, right, that particular possessing gene, I mean every gene codes for a product, right? So whatever the desired product required, for that particular product there is a gene responsible, so you need to cut that particular gene. Right? So that is possible with the restriction enzymes. So there are certain set of enzymes which help in the cleaving of the DNA sequences, which helps in the cutting of the DNA fragments. So they are also known as molecular scissors that cut the DNA at specific sequence, at specific locations only. Because we don't want the enzyme to cut the DNA anywhere, right? We want the gene of interest, means a particular segment of DNA only is required, right? So the restriction enzymes are very good at its mode of action, and they are going to cut at the specific locations only, okay? And it helps in the fragmentation of the DNA. So they are known as restriction enzymes. Next,
DNA ligase. What is this DNA ligase? Now, to form the recombinant DNA, we are going to isolate the gene of interest from a particular organism using restriction enzymes, right? And then you have to link this particular DNA to the vector DNA to form the recombinant DNA, right? Because recombinant DNA is nothing but linking of the gene of interest with the vector DNA. Together it is going to form the recombinant DNA. So now how you are going to join the two segments of DNA? Even the vector is a DNA sequence and gene of interest is also a DNA sequence. Both can be ligated with a particular enzyme known as DNA ligase. These are the enzymes that is going to join two fragments of DNA. So, they're going to join and reseal the gaps in the DNA fragments, okay, and facilitates the formation of hydrogen bonding at the sticky ends. And they're going to form the phosphodiester bonds with the adjacent nucleotides. As we all know that the nucleotides are made up of the polynucleotide chain, joining of one nucleotide with another nucleotide by a phosphodiester bond, right? So, this particular DNA ligase is going to form the phosphodiester bonds and it is going to join the two DNA sequences. One is gene of interest and other one is vector DNA. Not only gene of interest and vector DNA, always any two DNA fragments can be joined together with this DNA ligase enzyme. Next, we are going to see DNA polymerase enzyme. As I told, in the origin of replication, it is a DNA sequence that initiates the replication process. Now, how the replication process is going to take place? You are going to build up a DNA chain. Now, how you are going to construct a DNA chain? It is by adding the nucleotide bases, which is performed by the DNA polymerase enzyme. It is a DNA dependent enzyme. It is going to form the DNA chain. Okay, it is an enzyme in the host organism which carries out the replication of the recombinant DNA in the host cell. Right? And last, we are going to see what is the gene. So, we have everywhere it is gene transfer, gene cloning. Right? Now, what is this gene? Gene is nothing but it is a segment of DNA sequence or few nucleotide bases together form the gene. And these genes, some genes instruct the production of protein, okay? It is going to instruct the protein synthesis, when the protein has to be synthesized in the body. Everything is controlled by these DNA sequences only, known as genes. And what type of protein is formed, what type of hormones are formed, everything it is because of the gene. So, genes are nothing, they are the small segments of the DNA sequences. Now, we will see the first example of recombinant DNA technology, that is the construction of first artificial recombinant molecule using rDNA technology. So, we have seen that you people are aware now with the terminologies such as gene transfer, gene cloning, vector DNA, recombinant DNA, origin of replication, DNA ligase, DNA polymerase. So all these are the some of the terminologies and the processes that we are going to use while constructing a recombinant DNA using a genetic engineering or recombinant DNA technology. So one of the example that we can see, the first example of construction of artificial recombinant molecule. So, recombinant molecule is nothing but when the gene of interest or the foreign DNA for which you want to produce a desired character is linking with the vector DNA. So, vector is nothing but it is a carrier of gene that helps the multiplication of the desired gene in the host cell when it is linked to the gene of interest. Okay. So, now we will see the first artificial recombinant molecule. So, the first artificial recombinant molecule was constructed by the scientists Stanley Cohen and Herbert Boyer in the year 1972.
So, in the year 1972, the first recombinant molecule was constructed by scientists Stanley Cohen and Herbert Boyer. So, what they have done? So, while constructing the artificial recombinant DNA molecule, so they have linked the antibiotic resistance gene to the plasmid of the native plasmid of Salmonella typhimurium. It's a bacteria. So, how they have linked the antibiotic resistance gene? So, usually we have seen that the bacteria is going to possess some of the plasmids. And this one of the nature of these plasmids you have already studied in the previous class, previous year in the chapter Cell, the Unit of Life, that the plasmids have certain phenotypic characters such as antibiotic resistance character. So, for any character there will be certain genes. So, this antibiotic resistant gene of a plasmid of a bacteria is isolated and it is linked with the another plasmid, native plasmid of the Salmonella typhimurium bacteria. So, how they have done and how it is possible? So, the construction of the recombinant molecule using the rDNA technology involves three steps. Step 1, isolation and identification of DNA with desired gene. Okay? And step 2, introduction of the identified gene into host cell. Step 3, maintenance of the introduced DNA in the host and transfer of DNA to its progeny. So, what does the step 1 says? Isolation and identification of DNA with the desired gene. Isolation. So, now first thing is, you know there is a source from where the experiment says that we are going to link the antibiotic resistance gene. So, that is our desired gene. Antibiotic resistance gene is our desired gene. So, from where this antibiotic resistance gene is isolated. So, there will be a certain source, right? Whether it is from a human being or whether it is from animal source or it is from a microorganism. So, that particular isolation. Okay. So, first step is from which organism you are going to isolate and from which cell you are going to isolate this particular gene. So, first steps involves isolation and identification of DNA with desired gene. So, we want antibiotic resistance properties. So, we need the gene coding for antibiotic resistance and we know that they are found in the plasmids of the bacteria. Right? So, from the plasmid of the bacteria, you are going to isolate the plasmids of the bacteria and from that you are going to take out the antibiotic resistance gene. So, that is the first step, isolation and identification of DNA with desired gene. Second step is introduction of the identified gene into host cell. Now, what is the construction of the recombinant molecule is what? You are going to join two different DNAs and you are going to multiply the number of copies of the DNA. So, if you are just isolating the gene of interest, that is not the recombinant DNA, right? So, you are going to, what is the recombinant DNA? It must be linked with the vector DNA, right? So, second step is, you are going to introduction of the identified gene into host cell. So, in order to introduce it or in order to carry the gene of interest into the host cell, I mean in the other cell where it is getting multiplied, right? Now, for that particular reason, it must be linked to the vector DNA. As the definition of vector says that they are the carrier of genes or they have the self-replicating capacity. When the gene of interest is linked to the origin of replication of vector DNA, it is going to be multiplied in the host cell, right? So, the introduction of the identified is, you are going to link the gene of interest with the vector DNA and along with the whole thing is going to form the recombinant DNA and that recombinant DNA is introduced into the host cell, that is E. coli cell. So, in the next in the coming time, I am going to tell you, I will make a schematic diagram and I will explain the construction of this recombinant DNA molecule. First, you should know what are the steps involved in the recombinant DNA technology. So, then the next step is maintenance of introduced DNA in the host and transfer of DNA to its progeny. So, once
the vector DNA and the gene of interest are linked together, it is going to form the recombinant DNA. So if only recombinant DNA is formed, only one molecule is formed, it is of no use, right? We need a multiple copies of this recombinant DNA. When it is introduced into the host cell, and then if you are providing the good nutrients to it, the favorable conditions for the E. coli cells to multiply, then the same gene is going to be stabilized and is transferred to the next generation or its progeny or to its offsprings. So this completes the construction of artificial recombinant DNA molecule. That is isolation and identification of DNA from the source from which organism we are going to take up this gene of interest. Okay, and then introduce linking that gene of interest with the vector DNA for the introduction of this recombinant DNA to host cell. And then maintenance of the introduced DNA in the host cell by providing the favorable conditions for the multiplication of the E. coli cells. Usually in all conditions the cells will not replicate and the desired gene will not be expressed or multiplied. So the favorable conditions must be provided. So that means the maintenance of the introduced DNA in the host and transfer of DNA to its progeny. So now we have seen what are the steps of the genetic engineering for the construction of first artificial recombinant DNA molecule. So that steps are identification of DNA with the desirable gene, or from the source you are going to identify and isolate the gene of interest. So the first step is you are going to identify and isolate the gene of interest. So here we are going to have represented a schematic diagram. In this you are going to see how we are going to perform the gene cloning and create multiple copies of DNA. So the first step is identification, isolation of gene of interest. So the experiment says that the scientists have linked the antibiotic resistance gene with the plasmid of a native plasmid of the Salmonella typhimurium. Now the antibiotic resistance gene is isolated from a plasmid because we have heard that plasmids are containing the phenotypic character encoding genes, and one such character is antibiotic resistance gene. That is nothing but the gene produces a property for the antibiotic resistance, such as ampicillin, tetracycline, these are some of the antibodies. So usually the plasmids of E. coli has got the antibiotic resistance genes towards ampicillin, tetracycline, chlorpheniconazole, kanamycin. These are the some of the antibiotics, and these plasmids have the genes that are resistant to these antibiotics, right? So now we are going to isolate the gene of interest from the plasmid. So using the isolation procedure, we are going to first isolate the genetic material or the plasmids of the bacteria. So in this case it is a plasmid of E. coli. So the source is plasmid of E. coli. So this is the plasmid of E. coli. Now the whole plasmid doesn't have antibiotic resistance genes. So the whole plasmid is made up of the DNA, which is circular in nature, because the plasmids are nothing but their extra chromosomal circular double stranded DNA. So this is a DNA made up of nucleotides, right? Now in this area, only this particular region is the genes that is coding for antibiotic resistance. So other genes are coding for other proteins, but our gene of interest is the antibiotic resistance gene. Now from the whole plasmid of E. coli, we are going to isolate only the antibiotic resistance gene, that is our gene of interest. So how we are going to isolate that? So you need to cut this source, that is plasmid DNA of E. coli, at specific positions only. So we have seen certain set of enzymes. They are known as restriction endonucleases or restriction enzymes, which is going to cut the DNA at specific locations. which is going to cut the DNA at specific locations. So the restriction enzymes, I have already told the terminology, the definition. These are the set of enzymes that act upon the DNA at specific locations and causes the cleavage. So these plasmid DNA is cut at the site of the antibiotic resistant gene regions and it is segregated. This is a gene of interest, that is antibiotic resistance, and this is the remaining part of the plasmid. Now our interest is only the antibiotic resistance region, that is gene of interest, right? Now second step, what we have seen is introduction of this gene of interest into the host cell. So while introducing this, what we need to carry the gene of interest is the vector DNA. So this vector DNA is going to combine, is linked with the gene of interest, then only the whole thing, recombinant DNA, is inserted into the host cell, right? Now this gene of interest, okay, now the vector DNA is, once again we are taking the vectors, plasmids are the one of the type of the vectors that are used to carry the DNA into the other organism. So here the vector DNA is, once again it is a plasmid of the another bacteria, that is Salmonella typhimurium. From this plasmid it is taken as a vector, okay, and once again the whole vector, if the vector is again the circular DNA, now how you will attach the gene of interest? We cannot, because the whole thing is complete loop is there. So once again we need to create certain space to insert this gene of interest, that is once again done with the restriction enzymes. So the restriction enzyme is going to cut the specific position to insert the gene of interest. Okay, vector DNA is there, and in that you are creating the space, you removed, right? Now next, what we want to do, we have to link the vector DNA with the gene of interest. How we are going to link the vector DNA with the gene of interest? How we are going to link the vector DNA with gene of interest? So we have another enzyme known as DNA ligase. This DNA ligase is going to link the vector DNA with the gene of interest. So what is the function of this DNA ligase? DNA ligase is once again an enzyme which is going to reseal the two fragments of DNA by forming the phosphodiester bonds or by facilitating the hydrogen bonds of the two cut DNAs. Now one strand of DNA is linked with another strand through hydrogen bonding. Yes or no? Adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine, then the purines are paired with the pyrimidines by the hydrogen bonds. So the DNA ligase is going to facilitate the hydrogen bonding, as well as one nucleotide is linked with another nucleotide via phosphodiester bond. So the DNA ligase performs the formation of the phosphodiester bonds and links the vector DNA as well as the gene of interest. So now once again a circular DNA of a new combination of DNA is formed. That is, some of the genes of the vector DNA and some of the genes of the antibiotic resistance, that is our gene of interest, together it is going to form the new recombinant DNA molecule. So what is the definition of the recombinant DNA molecule? Recombinant DNA molecule is nothing but when a vector DNA linked with the gene of interest, together it is going to form a new combination of DNA known as recombinant DNA. Now we have the recombinant DNA. We have to introduce this recombinant DNA into the host cells. We have to introduce this recombinant DNA into the host cell, and that particular part is known as gene transfer. Okay, so right from the isolation of the gene till you produce the multiple copies of DNA, that particular process is known as gene cloning. So what we have studied, what is a gene cloning? It is once again the ability of the DNA to produce the multiple copies when linked with the vector DNA in the host cell. So the gene of interest, after linking the vector DNA and then inserted into the host cell, it is going to produce the multiple copies, and that process is known as gene cloning. So now the introduction of this recombinant DNA has to be done into the another host cell. So here the host cell is used is E. coli cells. Escherichia coli cells are used as host cells wherein the recombinant DNA can multiply. Now the plasmid is carrying the plasmid of Salmonella typhimurium. Okay, it is carrying the E. coli, and it is related, the Salmonella typhimurium similar to Salmonella typhimurium, other species is the E. coli, and in E. coli the recombinant DNA molecule is introduced. Now what will happen after the introduction of the the process of introducing the recombinant DNA molecule into the E. coli cells is known as gene transfer technique. And this, there are different types of gene transfer techniques to make the recombinant DNA molecule to take up by the cells, that we will be learning in the further classes. So right now the introducing the recombinant DNA into the host cell, and the third step of our recombinant DNA technology is maintenance of the copies of the recombinant DNA in the host cell as well as in its progeny or in the next generation. Now see, if the recombinant DNA is multiplied in the host cell, okay, fine, success is achieved. But what is the ultimate achievement? It is the same recombinant DNA, as the cell divides in its daughter cells also, it should possess the recombinant DNA only. Then there is a stable transformation can be considered. Right? If the parent is having this genetic material recombinant DNA molecule, and in the progeny cells or in the offspring, if there is no recombination of the DNA and it is having the original whatever the DNA of the E. coli, then there is no use of this recombinant DNA technology. You cannot produce any product. See how you can produce. So how the large amount of product is produced? You are going to grow the cultures, that is E. coli cultures or any specific cultures from which the gene is going to express, that is a recombinant DNA is going to express and form the product. So the rDNA, whatever is formed here, okay, this must be passed on to the progeny cells. Then only you are going to produce a large number of cells, because one cell when it is dividing the other cell, what is going to happen? The DNA replication is going to take place. That is, when you see the S phase of the cell cycle and cell division of the interphase, in the S phase, what is going to happen? DNA replication is going to take place. Now, when DNA replication process, the DNA synthesis has to take place. Now, then the replication process is going to take place, right? Now, multiple copies of the DNA can be formed when there is a DNA replication. How this DNA replication is going to take place? It is because of the, as I told you, when the DNA gene of interest linking to the vector DNA, okay, and this vector is going to possess the origin of replication. There is a sequence known as origin of replication. This sequence is going to initiate the replication of DNA, and it is going to, so that is sequence, this, there is an enzyme known as DNA polymerase enzyme. This enzyme uses or recognizes the origin of replication DNA sequence and performs the DNA replication. And once the DNA is replicated, okay, next it is going to enter into the mitosis and meiosis. It is going to form the multiple copies of the DNA. And so on, if many number of copies or many number of cells are produced with the recombinant DNA, they are going to express in the favorable conditions and form the product. So, when till you get the multiple copies of the DNA, till here it is known as gene cloning technique. It is known as gene cloning technique. So, all this together, these are the different techniques that is and different terminologies that is making up the recombinant DNA technology. So in the terminologies we have read what is restriction enzymes, what is origin of replication, what is vector DNA, what are the DNA ligases, right? So all these together are going to be involved in the recombinant DNA technology to form a new combination of the molecule known as recombinant DNA, which has the self-replicating capacity in the host cell. Why we are telling that self-replicating capacity? Because the DNA which is taken from one source, that is from some of the plasmid of the E. coli, now it is going to be multiplied in the and it is linked to the another DNA of the plasmid of the Salmonella typhimurium, and together it is forming a new combination and it is gaining the capacity of replicating again itself in the host cell, that is the other E. coli cells. So this process is known as gene cloning, that is a self-replicating capacity of the recombinant DNA molecule. When linked with the vector DNA and with the help of the origin of replication, it is going to produce the multiple copies of the DNA, right? So in the coming classes, in the further classes, we are going to see what are the restriction enzymes, types of the restriction enzymes, mode of the action of the restriction enzymes, okay, and what are the different types of vectors used for the purpose of cloning of plant cells, for the purpose of cloning of animal cells, because you are going to produce once again the multiple copies, and this is basically depending upon the vector and what are the properties of the vector. All these we are going to study in the further classes. So hope you all are clear with the schematic representation as well as with the explanation of the construction of the first artificial recombinant DNA molecule using recombinant DNA technology. So I will brief out today's class, that is the construction of the recombinant DNA technology as well as terminologies. You people are clear. So we will see the construction of the recombinant DNA technology. So in the what we are going to do initially, isolating the antibiotic resistance gene from the plasmids of antibiotic resistance strains of E. coli using restriction enzymes, right? And then you are going to after the restriction enzymes are acted, you are going to get the cut piece of the antibiotic resistance DNA was linked with the plasmid DNA of Salmonella typhimurium using the enzyme DNA ligase, right? And that acts on the cut DNA molecules and joins their ends. The plasmid DNA of Salmonella typhimurium acts as vector to transfer the piece of DNA attached to it to the host organism, that is the gene of interest to the host organism, that is the E. coli. So after the action of the DNA ligase, new combination of the DNA is produced. New combination of the DNA is produced in vitro, that is it is not within an organism. What has to take place within the organism, the scientists have developed it outside the organism, that is in vitro in the lab, which is capable of self-replicating, known as recombinant DNA. Recombinant DNA, then it is introduced into the E. coli cells using various gene transfer techniques, and the antibiotic resistance gene gets replicated and produces multiple copies in the host E. coli using its DNA polymerase enzyme, which is known as gene cloning. So the desired gene, that is antibiotic resistance copies, are produced in the large number.